little bit about. That's some of my motivation to be in science. And now that I'm starting to be a faculty member in the fall, and so I wanted to talk, you know, if there's anyone who is interested in going to UMass Amherst, I really pride myself on connecting with my students and connecting based on their different interests, research interests, and depending on what they want to do to mentor them in the way that's best for them. Some of the research that I've done, not related to bees, I've done some work on climate change and ecosystem services. I worked in a snail lab for 4 years, and so I've done some work with non-native movement of terrestrial snails, some tropical ecology and conservation, which I will continue to do in Costa Rica and in my home country of Colombia, and a lot of work on bumblebees. But under the umbrella of ecology and evidence-based invertebrate conservation, because I think the invertebrates do not get enough love, and they're so important for the well-being of all ecosystems. And as I mentioned, I'm starting as a faculty member in the fall in the Environmental Conservation Department. So if you have any questions at the end related to potential transfers or research, please, please come and ask me. So today's talk is all about bees. Does anyone know how many species of bees there are? Let me can anyone do a guess? How many species? Just in the world, how many do you think? 250. Cool, we have 250 over here. One more guess. 10,000. Double that. There are 20,000 species of bees in the world, when we usually just think about honeybees and bumblebees, right? But there's so much more diversity. And a lot of us have been hearing, bees are in decline, bees are in decline. So what is the reason for that? So there are many different interacting stressors. So you have pathogens, so diseases, loss of habitat, so natural meadows being converted to other types of landscapes, pesticide stress, and global change such as warming, drought, heat waves, etc. And so for the majority of this presentation and what I worked on for my dissertation was on pathogens. And so all of us have become acutely aware about disease transmission and contact networks and how transmission can be spread from person to person. But that can also happen for bees, and with very strong and negative impacts for bee health. Bee diseases can cause that. And so how can they be transmitted? One way is through shared use of floral resources. So you can imagine that there's a sick bee and she's going to a flower looking for pollen and nectar, but she's sick and she actually will accidentally leave some pathogen particles. And now this flower is contaminated. And so then you have another bee of the same or of another species. She comes in and now not only does she get sick, but she can vector it to another flower. And so this is why I titled the talk Dirty Doorknobs. It's just like, this is the platform for these bees are good, but they accidentally can actually pick up diseases inadvertently. And so we know from the literature, so here is you have different plant species. On the y-axis is you have how sick the bees get when they forage on them. And basically what I want to show you is that there are some like high transmission species, like the bees are very likely to get sick when they forage on these, and some low transmission species. So not all plants are created equal in that sense in terms of transmission potential. And so we wanted really to know, like, what are the factors that contribute to disease transmission on these flowers? You have some bees that are generalists. They love to visit many different plant species. They will visit many of them easily. Well, you have others, like here you have the squash bee. She's really focused. She's pretty much only gonna visit squash. That's what she likes and that's what she's gonna go for. And so you have these differences in interaction, and when you sum them together, you get what's called a plant pollinator network. So on the top, you have the different bee species. On the bottom, you have the different flower species. And basically this is what the number of times that this species goes to this plant species. And so you can see that there are many generalists and there are some that pretty much only go to one thing. And so just as we were thinking about with the earlier slide about the interaction and contact tracing, for example, for COVID, you could imagine that that framework could be useful when thinking about bees and bee disease transmission. But really, previously, no one had really explored how these contact networks could relate to pathogen transmission in bees. And you can imagine if you're this bee and you're in this beautiful meadow, you have all these different resources, your potential for transmission might look very different than if you're in a very simplified landscape. where you basically don't have a lot of options. You might all be concentrating on a little tiny patch that might be right here. There might be some weed that someone didn't mow. And so we really know that landscape simplification can influence bee abundance and diversity. So in more simplified landscapes, there are fewer bees. And not only are there fewer bees, but there's also lower richness and diversity. And we know that that diversity comes in many different forms. And so just as, you know, before we were saying how many species, 200, 10,000, there's 20,000. But not only are there the number of species, it's the diversity of what they look like. So there are many species that nest in different places. So most of them are ground nesting bees. There are some that nest in stems. There's even some, like this beautiful megachilid, that nests in abandoned snail shells. She sees an abandoned snail shell, she's like, that's a beautiful home. And so there's all of these axes of diversity that we often don't think about. And they also vary in size, in whether they're social or solitary. And all of this has the potential to influence how they're interacting with their surroundings and their exposure to pathogens. But again, we have no idea. Previously, no one had really looked at the relationship between these functional diversity traits and pathogens. And so when I was introducing myself, I brought to light that for me, conservation is really one of the big drivers. Like, I love thinking about how can we promote pollinator health, pollinator conservation. And so for the rest of the talk, I'll be coming back to the slide and making connections to what are future directions of research for pollinator conservation. And so the outline for this talk, we're going to start understanding the mechanisms that underpin disease spread on flowers, and then think about how this scales up. And we'll both look at that in terms of the landscape and in terms of those functional traits. Then we'll talk a little bit about solitary bees, because the social bees get all the attention, and that's not okay. And then we're going to talk a little bit about how flowers can serve also as medicine. So not only as the dirty doorknobs, but also as potential medicine for bees. And lastly, I'll introduce some ongoing projects and future directions that I'm working on. So let's start with the mechanisms. So in this, I want to talk a little bit about how infection influences disease transmission on flowers, how long these pathogens persist on the flowers, and if this translates to differences in infection. So this was a project that I did in Lynn Adler's lab with a team of high school students. And I was working with the common eastern bumblebee and three species of flower. And the pathogen is called Perfidia bombata. It doesn't have a common name. So basically, what I did was I fed these bees a fluorescent dye. And so what would happen is that then with a black light, I could see where they were defecating. And so it was a really interesting way of making sure of like, okay, where is the feces actually ending up on the plants? And we did that when they were infected and not infected with the pathogens. And so here, this is a Lobelia syphilitica leaf. It's basically, but you see that how there's orange? All of this orange is bee feces. And so this is, for example, we were saying like, where is it ending up? And we were finding that infected bees ended up were more likely to defecate than uninfected bees. And so the question is, wow, what's happening here? And so it's possible that there are some pathogens that irritate the gut lining. And so then they're potentially, there's dysentery, they might be defecating more. Or we know from the literature that these bees, when they're infected with this pathogen, they're slower. They have slower levels of foraging efficiency on the flower. So maybe they're just spending longer, and that's why these patterns are ending up. But again, because this is a fecal orally transmitted pathogen, if there's more feces ending up on the plant, there's more likelihood that the next individual will come, pick it up, and get sick. And so really, this is kind of the framework of how this transmission is happening. The three plant species that we were looking at have differences in terms of architecture and morphology. As you can see, some of them have a bigger tube, some of them are smaller. And so we wanted to look at the defecation rates on the different plant species and the different plant parts. And so here on the x-axis, what I'm showing you are the three different plant species, Lobelia syphilitica, Lythrum, and Monarda. On the y-axis is the number of times that we saw feces. And what it's colored is by the flower part. So you would imagine that if the feces is always ending up on the inside, for example, it would be blue across the board. But as you can see, that's definitely not the case. For Lobelia, it never ended up inside, while Lythrum pretty much very frequently on the inside. For Monarda, it was always outside. So what does that mean? What that means is that the feces isn't always ending up on the same place. It depends on the plant species where the feces is ending up. And not only that, these bees vary a lot in size. Even within a single colony, the worker case can vary dramatically in size. And so we also were interested in seeing whether the bee size influenced the defecation patterns on those flowers. And what we found was that the bigger bees were less likely to defecate on the inside than the smaller bees. And the reason that is that the little ones, when they go forage, they fit all the way inside. While those big ones, whenever they go, like, their abdomen actually sticks out. And so if they're defecating, it's ending outside. And that aligns with the patterns that we found. So the bigger ones are less likely to defecate on the inside. And so now we're getting a better sense of the basically the defecation patterns on these flowers. But then we wanted to know, okay, so what happens in real life? Imagine that a bee defecates on a flower, but it dies, the pathogen dies immediately. Then it doesn't matter, right? The next one comes in, the pathogen is no longer infectious. So we wanted to get a sense of what's happening outside. And also, how do environmental variables such as the sun influence these patterns? Because we know that UV radiation can kill many pathogens, or at least reduce their survival. And so we wanted to see the survival on the flowers. And so we basically were placing pathogens on different plant species and having them either on the sun or in the shade, and having that in different flower parts. And so what we found was, as predicted, here we have basically time of survival, like how long the pathogens are living. On the y-axis is the percent surviving. And it's colored based on whether you were exposed to the sun or you were shaded. And what you can see is that the ones that were exposed to the sun are dying more quickly than those that were shaded. And we found the same pattern for both of the species. So basically the sun is reducing the survival of the pathogens. And so that was aligned with what we had been predicting. And similarly, we looked at the different flower parts. And so here it's, you have whether you were on the bract, so basically the part outside of the flower, or the inside. And when they were on the inside, they were surviving longer. And so potentially it's because if you're on the inside, it's there's a microclimate, you're less exposed to evaporation and things like that. And so the survival is very different. Okay. And so then the last part of this section is, how does that influence infection dynamics? And so we basically wanted to place pathogens on different locations and see, like, are the bees getting infected or not? And so we basically found that the pathogens that were, when we were talking about the location, so like the inside would be the inside of the tube, the outside would be the outside of the tube, and the bract would be the area subtending the whole flower. And we basically found that on average, the bees that picked up the pathogens on the bract developed the highest levels of infection. And so why does this matter? When you put together, where are the bees defecating? Where is the feces ending up? How long is it surviving? And where are they picking it up? We hope that this can help us predict which plant species are more likely to result in outbreaks and disease spread events for these bees. And so in summary for this section, we found that infection resulted in greater levels of defecation on plants, that it's not all the same for all of the plant species, and that different bee sizes influence the patterns. We found that sun exposure was really important. So sun exposure reduced level of survival on the plants, and that varies by plant part. And that also plant part influences the infection for these bees. Okay, so that in general is the first section of the mechanism and the pattern that's happening on the flowers. And so one potential takeaway for conservation would be, could we test wildflower mixes that maximize UV exposure? So we know that, for example, some flowers are heliotropic, such as sunflower. They follow the sun. And so it'd be really interesting to see if flowers that are maximizing their exposure to the sun, is that also resulting in lower levels of survival of the pathogen? That's an area that we'd be interested in exploring. Okay, so that was the framework of transmission. And now, how does this actually scale up to communities? And so let's start with the area of landscape. So we wanted to know how widespread pathogens are in plant pollinator networks and whether landscape simplification could influence these patterns. So as we were talking about before, this environment that's very simplified has potential to influence disease dynamics, right, for the flowers, because you have very few options of what to visit. And so basically what we did is, along a gradient of landscape simplification. And what that means is sites where we planted wildflower, the same wildflower mix in an area in small farms that either had a lot of agriculture, here in yellow, or very little agriculture. So we had 11 sites that had either small, medium, or high, all the, and across a gradient of 11. I visited each site between 8 to 12 times throughout the summer. I collected the bees, which again, there's broad diversity, and then I screened them for pathogens using molecular methods. And so this is basically that network that I showed you at the beginning. This was the one for this one. So on the top, we have the different bee species, and on the bottom, we have the different plant species. And what you, and it, here it's colored based on the prevalence of pathogens. Green is if you have pathogen. There's green everywhere. It's not always dark green, but we've found pathogens in basically 65% of bee species and 75% of plant species. So there's pathogens in places where we had previously never even thought to look. We had historically just focused on honeybees and bumblebees. And so basically the first takeaway is that yes, pathogens are really widespread in these plant pollinator networks. And then the question about the landscape, we were basically looking at whether the landscape gradient, so how much agriculture you have around, influences pathogen prevalence either directly or mediated through interaction patterns of the whole network of bee abundance or of the common, the dominant species in the system, the common eastern bumblebee. And the, while the whole story is too complex for me to get into here, I'll basically just focus on basically that the common eastern bumblebee, that one that we had focused on the previous experiment, has the potential to influence disease transmission. So basically in more simplified landscapes, the common eastern bumblebee visited more plant species, and that resulted in lower levels of infection for the whole community. So basically the takeaway here is that the dominant species can have a disproportionate impact on the entire community. And that's something that has had historically not really been evaluated. And so the takeaway is that landscape simplification can shape prevalence and that the dominant species can really have a massive, massive effect. And so given the question of how landscape simplification is influencing this, it would be interesting to see if we could test wildflower mixes that maximize the interaction between like the dominant species and the rest of the community so that there's lower infection for the whole, for basically for everyone, because ideally we do want to minimize that disease spread for the community. Also, if at any point anyone has questions, there's something that's unclear, feel free to ask me as we're going or at the very end. That's also totally fine. Oh, yes.
When you're talking about the bee community, do you mean like multi-species or? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so are the pathogens that you're looking at like widespread across bee species or specific to?
Thank you so much for asking that. So historically, people had just kind of focused on honeybees and bumblebees, and within bumblebees, really only two species of bumblebees. But whenever we were screening them, I mean, we screened over 50 species of bee, and 65% of the bee species had at least one of the four pathogens that we were screening for. We were screening for a type of parasite called neogregorines and two species of fungi that are Nosema serrani and Nosema bombi and trypanosomes, which is the biggest one of those is Clothidia bombi from the previous one. And we were basically finding they're everywhere in these other species that, again, had previously not been looked at. Great question. Thank you. Okay. So now that we've thought a little bit about the landscape, what about those functional traits? Remember the earlier picture of like the social, there, some of them are big, some of them are small, some of them nest in snail shells. And so how does this functional diversity influence patterns? And so this was work that I did with an undergrad who did her honors thesis with me, Sally Compton. And we wanted to answer the question, can functional traits predict pathogen prevalence in a diverse bee community? And so in order to do this, we were looking at six different traits. One is size, and we predicted that bigger bees, which can forage further, would be more likely to have pathogens because they're, you know, potentially are exposed to more things. That social bees that are interacting with nest mates might be more likely to have pathogens. Those that are nesting underground that basically might be more protected from UV radiation, given our previous results, would be more likely to have pathogens. The females that are basically doing a lot of the foraging based on foraging for pollen would be more likely. that those that visit sunflower family relatives, which we'll get back to later in the talk. Okay. And then that those that forage later in the season might be more likely to have pathogens, because by then, potentially, there have been an accumulation of pathogens in the community. So we basically use the same bees collected from the landscape simplification project. Sally measured the distance between the wings, which is a good proxy for bee size for bees. And then we looked in the literature for the functional traits. So basically, are you how are you social or solitary? Where do you nest, et cetera? And then we evaluated it in relationship to these different pathogens. For today, I'll just focus on the trypanosomes, which includes the Clethidia bombi. And so what I'm showing you here are the different bee genera. So basically, the most common genera that we found. And on the y-axis is you have the percent that have pathogen, this pathogen. And it's colored based on what family you come from, if you're from the Apidae, Calidae, Helicidae, and Megacalidae. And what you can see is that there is a lot of variability. So it's actually great related to the question, the previous question of, are all of these bees having the pathogens? No, I mean, lots of them have them, but to different levels. Like the Ugla chlorella, which there was one species, this beautiful green bee, had a very high prevalence. 60% of the bees that we screened had pathogens. Well, for the lazy blossom, we screened over 100 bees, and it was less than 15%. So basically, pathogens are everywhere, but not all of them have it in the same amount. And so that our first takeaway was that taxa, that basically the bee taxa that you belong to really has an effect. And the Ugla chlorella, this beautiful green sweat bee, has the highest level. And so then we were looking at all of those functional traits that I introduced earlier. And what we found was that bigger bees were less likely to have pathogens, which was the opposite. We were thinking if you're bigger, you're foraging farther, you're more likely. No, we found that bigger bees, less likely to have pathogens. And that those that foraged later were also less likely, which again, we had predicted that if you're foraging later, maybe by then it's accumulated. So both of them was the opposite than what we had predicted. But this sweat bee is actually, it's a tiny bee, it's a very little one, and it forages early. So we thought, maybe it's just driven by one species. Like this species is maybe driving all of the patterns. And so whenever we excluded it, so no surprise, now there's no effect of size. Now size is no longer significant. So this is basically telling us that it's just the sweat bee that's driving all of the effects. Surprisingly though, we still found an effect of peak level of activity. Those that were foraging later were still less likely to have pathogens. And so this is telling us that basically you can't, sometimes it's just driven by a specific type of taxa, and sometimes it is the functional traits. And so why is that useful? That can help us predict basically to do certain types of tailored surveys in the future. And so if we know that those that are foraging later might be more likely to have pathogens, we can go and we can screen later in the season, specifically those bees, because they might be more likely to be sick. Okay, so what about solitary bees? What percentage of the bees in the world do you guys think are social? Like social as in like honeybee queen with her workers. Like what percent of those 20,000 do we think are social? Ooh, nice. So double that. You think 10% are social? Okay, another guess. You know that? You guys are super close. That's great. It's actually 20, like 80% are solitary. So it's about, you know, just about that. So because you have some that are, what's interesting is that you have the ones that are solitary. It's just one mama. She goes, she collects pollen. She'll basically make a pollen ball, lay her egg. That's it. You have some that are social. So you have a queen, the workers, you know, when we think about honeybees, social. You also have some that can be semi-social, that depending on where they are in, like even one species, depending on where she is, she might be social, she might be semi-social, she might be solitary. And there's also something called cuckoo bees. So that's like why, when you're saying, like, actually those numbers are a little hazy, but which basically, like cuckoo birds, you've heard of cuckoo birds, right? These bees, there's some species that like, they're like, I don't want to go and do all the work of getting the pollen. So I'm just going to go find the nest of a species, lay my egg on her pollen ball, and I'm out. So those numbers are kind of hazy, but for sure, 80% are solitary. And then within the social, it's between, you know, 15 or so, plus or minus, you know, these numbers, because it's not actually fully described for all species. Great. But good guesses for both of you. And so we do know that solitary bees are the majority, right? They're about 80%. And as I was showing in an earlier graph, pathogens are everywhere. It's not just the social bees. And solitary bees actually do a lot of the work in terms of pollination services. And so we really wanted to know what's going on. Because whenever, for this graph that I'm showing you, we're screening using molecular methods. So basically, like the PCR, you know how for whenever for COVID testing, you can go and do PCR, it can tell you if you have it in your system. But for these, it could just mean that it's passing through its gut, not that it's actually, not that the pathogen is replicating. Like imagine you eat something that's contaminated with a bacteria, but the bacteria is dead and it's passing through. If they were to do a sampling, you might test positive for the gut for that specific thing, even if it's not replicating. And so we don't actually know how many of these positives that we have, the bees are actually sick with it. And so we wanted to do, to start to answer that, we basically wanted to inoculate two species of solitary bee. So you have the alfalfa leaf cutter bee. I mean, look at this little cutie. And then the blue mason bee, Osmia ligneria, and infecting it with the same pathogen. And so you have two species of commercially available solitary bees that are uninfected. And so we give them specific doses and then we monitor them for about 2 weeks to see what happens. And so this was done with a fantastic undergrad student, Callie Grinkovich, who worked with me on this. And so we basically would do that with these species and leave them in these little housing containers and monitor them for 2 weeks. And so what we found is the following. So before I show you the results, I'll just walk you through the axis, through the figure. So here you have two species, right? You have the alfalfa leafcutter bee and the blue mason bee. On the y-axis, you have how sick you are, like basically how many pathogen cells you have in your gut after we dissected them. And these red lines are how many cells we gave them. So for as a comparison point, one of my good colleagues did this experiment with syrphid flies, which are flies that actually go and pollinate in nature as well. And so she basically fed them these Scrophidia cells, and she was finding that they were able to defecate and the feces was still infectious. But after a week, none of them left. They basically just like, it went right through them. The pathogen went through. It's still infectious, but then it's not replicating. And so for them, this basically, their results was nothing. After a week, no cells. What we found, now these are the points of the cells that we found, not only are they still around after 1 week, but a lot of them are much more than the values that we gave them. And so this is indicating that the pathogens are likely replicating inside of these hosts. And so that's something that really hadn't really been evaluated before, because again, most of the work has focused on honeybees and bumblebees, even though solitary bees are the majority of species on the planet. And so while this is really a good first step for understanding that these pathogens, these bees can get infected, we have no idea what that means for them in the wild. We don't know if this affects their ability to pollinate. We don't know how this affects their survival rates. We don't know how this interacts with pesticides. Because for the work that has been done for honeybees and bumblebees, it's if you are sick and you're starved and you have a little bit of poison, oof, it's really so much worse. And so we really need to look at all of these interactions in the field in a way that's not just one isolated stressor, but interacting stressors. And so that's really an important point for future directions of this work. And so then one area that I've actually been working on for my postdoc is, okay, so now clearly these flowers can serve as dirty doorknobs where there's transmission, can they actually also serve as medicine for these bees? And so this is work that I've done with Lynn Adler at UMass and other collaborators. They made this discovery a few years ago that sunflower pollen, which is this spiky thing that you see here, can actually result in unbelievably antipathogenic for the common eastern bumblebee when it's infected with Clothidia bombi. Basically, whenever this species eats sunflower pollen, they don't get sick. It's just like they've replicated it a bunch of times. When they eat sunflower pollen, they don't get sick, but they don't really know why. And so, I mean, this is pretty spiky. You can see it's very like that's not all pollen looks like that, actually. But pollen is also very chemically diverse. And so we wanted to know if it was like the physical structure or if it was the chemistry. Like an example of a physical structure, there are some great apes that whenever they're infected with tapeworms, they'll eat bristly leaves that will actually make them like have expulsion and clear out the pathogen. So that works with many tapeworms. And so we wanted to know, maybe it's the physical, maybe it's the chemical, or maybe it's both. And so to do that, we basically looked at sunflower pollen, which as you can see is very spiky, compared to two controls, buckwheat, which is smooth, and then a mixture of species. And we basically just either looked at the chemistry or just the shells. So no, without any chemistry. And we did that for our relevant controls as well. And the reason we wanted to have the controls is that these are same level of protein, but the bees usually get sick when they eat buckwheat in terms of for this pathogen. And so this is what we found. This is a kind of a complicated figure, but we're going to work through it together. Basically, on the x-axis, you have all of the different diet treatments. So if you were whole wildflower pollen, if you were buckwheat or sunflower, and for buckwheat and sunflower, if you were just the chemistry, the whole pollen, or just the shell. And so we're starting with just the wildflower, so this is a good baseline. Then if you look at buckwheat, pretty much they're all there. You know, all of them are getting sick. And then now I just added sunflower. You basically can't even see it, right? Like if you eat sunflower pollen, I mean, right? Can you even see the, there's nothing. It's tiny. It's at the very bottom. And so we then looked at the sunflower chemistry. That's a lot higher. And now the last one I'm going to show you is just the shell, no chemistry. Also tiny. So what this tells us is it's basically just the sunflower spiky shell that's driving this medicinal effect. It's not the chemistry, it's the shell. And so that was really, really exciting. And then we wanted to know, well, there are other species of sunflower that are also spiny. Could they also have this medicinal effect? And so then we screened seven other species that also have different degrees of spininess. And we actually found that overall, a lot of the sunflower family relatives here in orange compared to their controls that are in black resulted in much lower infections. And so basically, in general, we're finding that sunflower family relatives are having these antipathogenic effects. And so given these results, we applied and we're very happy to get an NSF Integrative Biology grant, where we're basically collaborating with molecular biologists, we're working with chemical ecologists, mathematical modelers, to look at how this interaction between sunflower pollen goes from the cellular level all the way to the landscape. And for the landscape part, we're really wanting to know, okay, so what happens when you have different proportions of sunflower plantings, sunflower pollen relatives in nature? Does that influence how the common eastern bumblebee is doing? And can that have knockdown effects for the other species in the area? Because, right, like they're all sharing the same resources. And so we're working with different homeowners and land managers in different areas and different parks to see, to get a gradient of sunflower. And that actually includes GCC. So that's something, that's actually how Tony and I connected last year. I had reached out to him and he was so kind and generous. And so this is one of our sites for this experiment, where basically this, you all are planting one of our mixes that has a high proportion of sunflower family relatives. And so this is something that we're, it's a project that's ongoing. It's, we have four additional years of funding. And so by the end of that, I hope to have a more complete story of what's happening. And, you know, I'm so grateful that GCC is contributing in our helping us answer these questions of how sunflower pollen and their relatives can influence bee health. And so then for the very last part, I want to talk about a few additional projects and future research. And so we basically, if we want to know what we're losing, we need to know what we have. And to know what we have, we need to be able to monitor the species. And so something that I've been really excited about and working on for a couple of years is thinking about automated monitoring programs. And so basically what this would mean is that, can we monitor bees in a way that is non-lethal? Because current strategies for monitoring are lethal. And so I've been working with different students to develop basically a recorder that you can deploy outside, and it can basically, have you ever been outside and then you're like, you hear a bee and you know that it's a bee, right? Like you can detect that there is a bee just based on what it sounds like. And you can tell that it's different from a plane. You can tell that it's different from a car because it sounds very particular. And so we basically want to leverage the fact that bees sound so particular to train machine learning algorithms to say, that sound, that's a bee. That sound, that's a plane. Don't worry, that's not a bee. And so we're basically, we've been gathering a lot of data to be able to differentiate species based on sound. And so that is an ongoing project that I'm really, really excited about. And so we are basically, as I was saying, we're basically leveraging machine learning algorithms to be able to tell like, oh, this is a common eastern bumblebee. This is a honeybee based on sound. But that project is currently ongoing, and I hope to have a better update in about a year or so. And so the benefits of doing this, it's that it is fully standardized. There's not as much bias in terms of if you're doing, let's say the alternative is either sweep netting. And so then that really depends on if you're really good at sweep netting, you might get a lot of bees. And if you're not very good, then you might not. And so then how do you compare that across large spatial scales? It's non-lethal because a lot of the sampling is putting out bowl traps. And while that's really good for getting fine grain resolution of species identity, that's not often what we necessarily need to do. And so this is a non-lethal alternative. And it allows for sampling in otherwise inaccessible locations simultaneously. So one thing that I'm really excited about is looking at bees and trees. So what's happening in the canopy of trees? That's an area that has historically been overlooked. And so we can deploy these, that's something that I'm hoping to do starting next year, is to deploy these recorders in tree canopies and see like what's going on up there. And so this can allow us to really monitor bees in terms of both conservation and agricultural applications, because we can also detect based on sound whether pollination has occurred. And so based on this, we have a new grant that's evaluating basically bee activity in solar facilities. And so we're deploying these recorders at solar sites that either have pollinator habitat or don't, to see like, are we actually getting more bees or are we not? Because there, it's sometimes you can just, we don't want to make assumptions about conservation that may or may not be accurate. So we're actually testing this specifically starting this summer. Actually with an alum from GCC is working with me on this. So that's very exciting, and a GCC connection. And so hopefully this technology, I hope, will enable me to continue to work towards a greater understanding of the stressors that influence pollinator health, so that hopefully we can make informed decisions that can help. And so with that, I'd like to acknowledge all of my collaborators and funding sources and all of you for being here. And so I would be super happy to take any questions. Oh, yeah, for sure.
Hello?
Oh, yeah, this is loud. Hopefully you were able to hear me okay. Okay. Any questions about bees, about UMass, about anything?
Hello, thank you very much. It was really great talk. And also congratulations on getting a faculty position at the university. That's a great accomplishment for yourself. Two questions, a little bit different. One is, you made a reference and showed a map of an agricultural area up in New York. Were you primarily looking at that because it was a monoculture? And was that the idea?
So they were not monoculture. They were small, mostly small diversified vegetable farms, actually. But some of them were smaller and larger. And so if you are in a small patch that is agricultural, but around you, you have forests, around you, you have meadow, in terms of if you're a bee, you might be okay to deal with like a little bit of agriculture. So we wanted to do that gradient. But it's, they weren't all monoculture corn, for example. They were diversified vegetable farms mostly.
And now my other question is about, this is with the social bees.
Oh, yeah.
So do you think the social bees will tell their other bees where the pollen is. Yeah. And do you think those social bees are telling their other friend bees, I'm putting my head of a bee, of don't go to those plants because they have pathogens?
Oh, that's such a good question. So for the first part, definitely social bees have super interesting communication. They will tell their nest mates where is a good area to forage. Like, and so, for example, one big notable case is the honeybee and the waggle dance. So they basically, they do a particular type of dance when they find like, oof, that's the stuff. And so they'll come, and depending on how enthusiastic their dancing is, more sisters will come. And occasionally there will be two resources. And one sister's like, go here. And she's dancing like this. And the other one's no, there. And so depending on how excited the dancing, like they'll be like, I'm not going with you. Look at her dancing. And then they'll go, they'll follow the one that's dancing more enthusiastically. It's really fascinating. And so for the first part of your question, yes, they definitely communicate. For the second part, it's not well understood just how much the bees can actually tell that there's pathogens on flowers. There's been one paper so far that showed that they might, but it's not the most robust publication. And we don't really know if they're making these like self-selecting medicinal choices, but it's something that we're really interested in looking at as a lab. So great question, still to be.
For social bees, when they take a pathogen back to the nest, I know that it's spread through flowers, but is it also spread back at the nest in any way?
Great question. Absolutely. So it actually, because it's fecal orally transmitted, they can come in, and then imagine if you're defecating in the colony and all of your sisters are around and all of the babies are there, that's actually a very effective way of for there to actually be outbreaks, because there's no sun. It's very humid in there. Pathogens can easily like, not they can more easily survive than they could on the harsh environments like such as the flower. So it's a great question, and definitely that's a very common place. So of the sources of transmission, you have sexually transmitted pathogens. That's not very common for bees. You have flowers, which occurs and especially common for between species, but for social bees, for sure, within the hive is one of the more common places.
Thank you.
Okay, I've got another question, or I guess two. So with the pathogen you're looking at, or that you've primarily been looking at, are those pathogens that like arose in the U.S.? And I guess either way, do you notice a difference in susceptibility to the disease in native versus non-native bees?
Both really good questions. So in terms of whether it's native to, so the, it's kind, it has like a pan, it, the distribution of Clothidia is pretty much everywhere. It's really distributed globally. In terms of natives or non-natives, we do know that, we don't know really how much it affects most species. For the effect of sunflower, though, we have looked at how the anti-parasitic effects of sunflower on a couple of species. And we find that on the dominant species, it's really strong, but on a couple of the other native species, some of which could be more in decline, it's not as strong. So it's not, sunflower isn't affecting all of them equally. And so clearly this pathogen influences different kinds of bees more strongly. To your question, it's not the bees that we were working in, but bumblebees are, you can buy bumblebees, and people do buy them for commercial processes. Like you can buy, if you're a farmer, you can buy, bring it in for your, for tomato pollination, for example. And that actually can even occur across countries, and until very recently had been very poorly regulated. And so there's a strong case that the introduction of Bombus terrestris from Europe into South America was actually associated with the decline of one of their native species through pathogens. And so, because again, as they come in, then they're foraging on the same flowers as the native bees, and the native bees get sick. And that one wasn't with Clothidia bombi, my pathogen, but well, the pathogen that I've worked with, but with a type of Neogregorian apocystis. And that one really, like that bumblebee, that was like one of the biggest bumblebee species in the world. And now you can barely find it. So thanks.
Laura, I want to ask a few questions, but first off, the honeybee industry, I would imagine, was where they've noticed a lot of the, that's how it kind of drove a lot of this research recently. And how much is the honeybee industry in moving hives around either within a continent or, like we're saying, across oceans, how much is that affecting the health of the species and the transmission to a variety of different species?
Totally. That's a very good question too. So we, in a lot of contexts, we don't have a pre-honeybee invasion to post. And so to do like a really quantitative assessment is very difficult. In some islands, they've been able to do it more closely because in an island setting, especially if you're on a small island, you can more clearly regulate like what's happening when you have honeybees versus what happens when you don't. And most of what is documented in terms of this phenomenon called pathogen spillover is with viruses. And there are strong associations. Whenever honeybees are around, wild bees tend to have more viruses, higher virus loads and higher virus diversity. And so it's very possible. But again, it's been challenging to document in a very robust way because right now there's so many pathogens everywhere. But there are some works showing that both honeybees and bumblebees, the closer you are to an apiary, the higher the levels of pathogens surrounding it. And so there's definitely strong evidence. But again, we're limited in some of the ways just because the movement of honeybees is so massive. I mean, it's thousands and thousands of colonies all over the United States on an annual basis. Any other questions?
So I'm curious about your bioacoustics experiment. So this recording device, is it able to just distinguish the buzzes between like different species of bees, or is it just like that's a bee?
The questions are so fire right now. It's so good. So the idea is that ultimately it will be able to classify among many different species of bee. There is one example with mosquitoes of the type of similar type of algorithm that can differentiate among 16 species of mosquito. I mean, I can't tell 16 species of mosquito by ear. They all sound like mosquito. But that means that this technology has the potential to really differentiate and notice fine scale differences. But what I've learned through this data collection is you need so much data to train these models that so far I just have it for the common eastern bumblebee and honeybees. And then for bumblebees, I have it when, like the common eastern bumblebee when it's flying and when it's buzz pollinating, which for, this is a horticulture class. So for Solanum species, so those in the tomato family, their anthers are together. And whenever to get pollinated, it needs a very specific kind of frequency for the pollen to be released. And so whenever bumblebees buzz pollinate, it's a very particular sound. It's different from them flying. And so we're training the model to be able to tell when the buzzing is occurring, like for buzz pollination. But so far we have those three. Longer term, I'd love to include many, many other species.
I was just curious about the sound again. So are you getting these sounds from, like, are you going out to a field and finding these bees, or you bring them into?
No, totally. So at first we were working just like a little bit inside, but then most of our collection was actually done out. Like, we tried to do as many background contexts as possible. The reason being is that one of my collaborators told me an anecdote of someone who was interested in learning about a grasshopper, training a grasshopper model, but they did all of their recordings inside. And what they didn't realize was that the refrigerator was on making noise, and the model, like every single recording was with the refrigerator on. And so then the model learned to identify refrigerator with like the annotations. And so we want to avoid that at all costs. And so we've been, you know, really trying to do, okay, in a community garden, in a natural meadow, somewhere farther away, somewhere where there's plains, somewhere where there's lawnmowers, to avoid just that. But we do have some recordings that we did inside just for higher quality, controlling the background noise.
Hi. It's time to start working on my garden this year. I'll be for sure adding sunflowers to the mix. And I saw from one of your slides that there's a sunflower family, and you passed over the slide real quickly, but what were some of the other flowers in the sunflower family?
Yes. Yeah, so the one that, the ones that we screened, so in order to test this, we need to have a high amount of pollen for the trials. And collecting pollen manually is unbelievably time intensive. And even the ones that you get like from honeybee collected pollen, you're limited by which monocultures have flowering plants. And so what we actually decided to do was use allergy companies, because allergy companies do the like the manual collection. And so that for those species, the reason we have these species is that these are the ones that are available from the allergy companies, not so much that these are the ones that we're recommending. So basically these pattern is to show that the patterns are widespread in the sunflower family, not that we necessarily recommend that these species be planted. And so it's more of like when you're in planting your garden, I recommend that you think about what are other types of native species that are sunflowers. So for example, echinacea or other types of species that are native to the area and are also sunflower, and include that as part of the mix. So some of the work that Lynn's previous student, Jonathan Giacomini, did, he evaluated, because sunflower pollen is, I mean, it is really spiky, it's hard to digest. So it's not that we want only sunflower. And so they did a cool project where they were looking at, do you still get the medicinal effect if it's 50%? Or does it need to be 100% flower? And they're finding the same medicinal effect if it's just mixed in. And so I think just if you can incorporate, yeah, a couple of other native perennial sunflower family relatives. And we've actually developed a mix, which is the one that they're planting here. And I'm happy to send you the list of species after.
Yeah, I guess I wanted to follow up on that comment or the question of what we have done here and then how we can... several years ago, we planted a wildflower meadow on the south side of the building. Black-eyed Susan, no, this was Rebecca, very similar. It is in the sunflower. Monoculture. So last fall, I planted a diverse mix, probably had, I would imagine, about 25 species, quite a few species. But I'm wondering what, in the future, what will you be looking at, you know, if we do get a successful plot there, and how are, you know, what are you going to use for, you know, what kind of information can you gather from this?
Totally. So our plan is basically to monitor a couple of things. One, we want to look at the abundance and diversity, but also the feces. We want to like do fecal assessments of how sick are they. And we, not only the common eastern bumblebee, which is the one that we know has this medicinal effect and relationship with sunflower, but what about those other ones? And so we're going to be doing, again, documenting bee abundance, diversity, and then also just screening the other species too, in terms of how are they doing and how is their resiliency and their relationship to this effect.
I want to dominate the question, but I have one other question for you. I know that, you know, we have kind of, when you look at what's happening out there right now, there are much fewer flowers now than there are in the middle of summer. Mm-hmm. You might have a dearth in the summer too, mm-hmm. where you don't have flowering species, you have less flowering species. So how does that impact? And then actually going fewer species in the fall when you might goldenrod mm-hmm. or the asters when abundant, but there's not diversity.
Mm-hmm. Totally. So I've done some work looking at the effect of dilution. And so that was part of, let's see if I have it, the slides up here. where we were basically looking at what happens when the bees are concentrated in a resource. And what we want is for there to be more interactions with more species. So I think if they're only concentrating on one hub, the probability of transmission is higher. And so we want there to be more. And so what we did for the development of the seed mixture was we specifically made sure that it wasn't, they weren't all going to bloom in June and then that's it. We had some that are blooming that should ideally start blooming from May all the way to September with different species in each little block so that it's not just a dearth. Because ideally we want the, just as we wouldn't want to have a period where we don't eat, we want to have long availability throughout the summer. Because for sure, if there's really strong spikes in concentration, that will influence bees. Bees also vary in terms of their phenological activity. So phenology, that's described as like activity period, it varies within the day. So some species, like the squash bee that I showed at the very beginning, the specialist, she's active super early. So I had a colleague who worked on her, and like her field season was from like 4 a.m. until 8 a.m. and then that she was done. While for most bees, it's like 8 a.m. until 4 p.m. So within the day, but also within the season. And so that was related to that project of like the level of activity, the phenological level of activity. Some bees forage only in the spring. So you have some bees that are at the andrenity. They're really just kind of right now and for about another month, they're active. You have some that are later active only for about a month later in the summer. You have some that are active, like the common Eastern bumblebee, she's active the whole season. And so within and across species, there's differences in this level of activity period that will likely influence when and how they're interacting with the flowers with potential for transmission. Such good questions. Thank you all so much. This is great. Of course. My pleasure. And I'm happy to take any questions after if you want to just come up.